Bible Messages, your 3000. We hope that you have that with you. Also, the Gospel of John today, and we're going to be in the very last page of this. They were in chapter 21, I think it's page 46, and we're going to finish up our study, although next week is the final chapter of the study, and it's going to be a surprise, but here's the cool thing about it. You got to be here to find out what the surprise is. So it's Mother's Day, but we challenge before Easter, coming all the way through, so let's just make it about Easter, let's make it the week before, and then go all the way through until Mother's Day. We've been talking about going from disciples to an apostle. The disciples were discipled by Jesus for 3 years, and then he sent them out. There were times in there that he also sent them out, two by two, to let us someone alongside of us. And at the same time, we're going to look at those examples that we have around us. So today, we're going to be in chapter 21. We're going to start in verse 9, where we're going to jump all the way through a couple of different areas. You can fill your Bible study book out. I'm going to say this probably 5 times today. Outside, on the information center, on both the Gospel of John and in the study guide, grab what you believe and send them or share them or give them, whatever is the easiest way for you to do that, with people that you love. Get them on a track where they're starting to study God's Word. It's so important for them to know that God loves them. But the only way they're going to truly know that God loves them, especially when we're going to see just some of the examples today, is just spending time in this love letter. You can't learn from God's Word if the book stays closed. It has to be open. Okay? So once again, disciples to apostles, let's go today and put a prayer with that. Heavenly Father, as we come to you, God, this day, continue to watch over this time, Lord. Almost for just a moment, as we end this chapter of John, this book of John, help us to know that at the end of the line is love and peace and hope. And God, that we get to carry that with us every single day. So as we are learning today, Lord, help us to understand all the things that kind of get in the way in our lives. But at the end of that day, God, as we just turn to you, Lord, help us start our day with you. Help us to carry with us wherever we go. And Lord, you've got all this. So help us to trust and believe in that. In your name we pray. Amen. Okay, so let's show you a picture here. Go ahead, Tim. How many people remember this guy right here? 4 people. So, he was a missionary that came in here. Just kind of tell some time, you don't have to speak somewhere where they're at. This is Dante Savatucci. Dante was a missionary. And he also owned a baseball academy. And so, when we were having discussions every time I would go and sit down with him, he was trying to get something squared away because they made changes because of the small business guy. And he was trying to get something expanded, and there was something that was wrong with the bathroom, and the inspector was mad about this. And he was like, I'll do whatever I have to do to get it right. But somebody's got to have like a special piece. So we would talk, and we would be on hold, and we would have some discussion about his mission trip, and then they would come off hold, they'd ask him a couple questions, and he would answer them, and then we'd put him back on hold, and we'd go through and talk more about his mission trip, and this went about 3 or 4 times, and then, as we all know, all of a sudden the line went dead. And when that happened, he's got to start over. And Dante, I love the faces, he handled it really, really, really well. And he just looked at them, well, obviously, I'm not going to be talking to him today. Constantly, this happened to him where he was running up against this and making these phone calls, and he was just trying to be the best example he could be that when the people didn't have the answer, they just hung up on him. So he just decided, you know what? I'm done with it. First of all, before he did that, he goes on this mission trip. And on the mission trip, he goes down, and he's able to reach 600 people with the Spanish edition of Gospel John. He reached out and baseball guys that were down there for a 1-week mission trip. And when he came back, he started getting pictures from this missionary that was in the Dominican Republic. Here's the cool thing about it. The guy that was there was an ordained pastor, but first he was a baseball player. And when he went through and he thought he was a double A or double A as far as a baseball player, he decided, I'm going to go back home because God has blessed me so much that I want to reach out to other people to let them know how much they're loved, even though they have very little. So this baseball player's kind of passion started going from village to village in his life, and they started having studies. They got to the point where his wife was studying with all the gals, he was studying with the guys, he would teach all of them baseball. But if they wanted to do the Bible study, they had to sign up for it and to be part. He wasn't just going to do it away. And so let's say 50 kids would show up to learn how to play baseball. When they were done, 10 to 15 of them would see a story about Jesus. But he still wanted to love all of them because there was always a chance that those that were hearing would come to be part of that. Village by village, he goes out to reach people. a day where we had 600 people to the point where he completely ran out. On his second trip, he had to reach out to another missionary and said, is there any way that you can bring more of these down? Because we are reaching so many people here, and we're on the discipleship track with them. So we're now there's almost 1,000 people that they're have reached just from the Dominican Republic alone. When I say reach, I mean they're studying together. We fund day by day, depending on where they're at. Whether they're actually reading it, whether they're actually talking about it, whether they're actually penetrating their minds and their hearts, and people are getting saved. That is an amazing thing. And it started because this guy right here knew that when he went down there, there was something that was missing. So he would take out a bag of baseball equipment and he would give it to his kids and he'd teach them how to play baseball and he'd come home and he'd be like, I taught him how to play baseball and, you know, I tossed him some softballs and I taught him how to, you know, use the glove and I took gloves down to him to give away all, but there was always something missing. Well, that day when he came back, he decided, I've had enough. I wasn't going to use one with the government. So he's a small business owner. He takes on his heritage, he's going to continue to go back and forth to the Dominican Republic. And on whatever the voting day is, what is it, May 3rd? Tuesday? Is that Tuesday? Tuesday, the voting day. He is now running for Congress. In District 13, or like 13 guys or whatever. But you'll see the name Dante Salvatucci there. And you know why he's doing it? Because he knows that the message of who Jesus is not in Washington anymore. He knows that when they stand on things, it has nothing to do with God and who God is and what God has done for us. So he has finally decided, I'm done, and I'm at least going to try with God wants me in office. So put me in office, and if not, I made lots of contacts, and he did everything that he found out. So many people have reached out to him because of his belief, and so many people have reached out and said, I need to do more. I need to take that step from disciple to apostle. And it's something that we all have to make a decision on sooner or later. Now, we'll be heading back down to the Dominican here in the fall, and we're going to bring it back up. We're going to bring in the second missionary as well. Probably somewhere around the September time frame when his case center is squared away. Because I'm excited he'll be talking to nothing today as well. But once again, they made the decision to go from disciple to apostle. Now, things can get in our way, though. And there's things that used to kind of get in our way as well. Where, okay, I want to be a disciple and I want to get to the point of being an apostle. So, on this very little picture, and this is sadly up today. Go ahead and show this picture. It reads that Jesus tried to feed the 5,000. He's holding up the bread and the loaf. And the first guy says, I can't eat that, I'm a vegan. The second one says, has that chicken tested for mercury? The third one says, is that bread gluten free? So she's going to read it. And that, many times, where we're at is that we can take this and we kind of laugh and we go, okay, but there's always these things that all of a sudden pop up in our mind and they get in the way of our walk with God. So many times we think that we're alone with that. We think we're the only ones that are complaining. We think we're the only ones that make excuses. We think that we're the only ones with the busy schedules. We think that we're the only ones that didn't fit God in today. And so we continue along that line of being that disciple and hearing about God's word and saying, yes, it can do wonderful things in my life. It can make a change. But then we are the ones who don't take the step. And because of it, we're the ones left wanting. And who we beat up? Get ourselves up. Even though we're examples around us, like, even that guy works 100 hours a week and yet he's still reaching out to people. Somehow he finds time in the day to do so. It's not that he finds time in the day to do so, it's that part of his 100 hours are to represent who God is. And he shared it with workers, and he shared it with strangers, and he shared it with, you know, family, whatever it might be. And so today, Jesus is talking with his disciples. He's about ready to head out. This is the third time that he has come back after the resurrection. So Jesus died, he comes back before them, and he's talking with just the disciples. That's it. And we talked about it last week, how Simon Peter was the leader of them. And Simon Peter had denied him 3 times, and yet still, Jesus came back for him. So no matter what your biggest struggle is, no matter how bad it gets, remember that Peter denied Jesus 3 times. One time he actually swore, and the other time, the final time, he actually looked at Jesus eye-to-eye, face-to-face, and his final denial, and then he left. And yet, Jesus came back for him, and he built the church upon him and upon all of the other disciples. He trusted them because those disciples trusted in God. But it was them that had to make the choice to go from that disciple to becoming that apostle. So, if you've got your Bible there, if you look at this starting in verse 9, they come back up on the shore and says, so when they got out on the land, they saw a fire of coals there, with meat, with fish and bread laid on it. And Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish which you have just caught. Now, verse 9:10, the study note says this, and this is in your Bible study book. Where did the fish on the fire come from? Since the disciples hadn't even brought the net full of fish on the shore at this point. So I'm hoping that you're going to write some of these things down in different notes like that, because eventually the hope is that you too will use it so that you can share with others. But the place to start your Bible study, the place to go if you want to sit down with someone, is not in the beginning with Genesis. Because when you start there, there's going to be so many questions, and for a new believer, they're going to get Jesus completely. Start in the Gospel of John. We start with Jesus, and then we take it elsewhere. So that's why we start with John. Why John? Matthew's written to the Jews. I teach for the Jews. Mark was written to the Romans. Luke was written to the Greeks. John was written to the Gentiles. If you're not a Jew, you are a Gentile. We talked about that this past week. This Gospel is for you, and it's for me. So as you're going through, write some notes down, because this is really important. Where did this come from? How is it that Jesus, these guys were out fishing the whole night, there's no fish. All of a sudden, they get the biggest catch that they're going to catch. And but there's fish that are on the shore, and where's that kind of happen? But then, here's the bottom line, and as we read this, let's know. It says, this shows that God teaches things at any time on his own without us. Sometimes we'll sing miracles out of the hat, and we have to thank to God. Well, God chose to do that miracle without us. There's other times where he'll do a miracle through us, and we know that we'll recognize it. Jesus invites the disciples to bring some of the fish to join in the meal they're about to have together. God can and will do it alone, but he is a relational God. He wants us to join with him and take part. But here's the thing about it. Relationships are two ways. We give and we take. We give and we take. God is not going to force himself on you. He's not going to force himself on me. It is our choices of whether or not we choose to live his love through him and to others. That is our choice. And God's going to keep loving no matter what. And God's going to keep providing no matter what. But do you recognize God within the moment? So that's what happened to the disciples. It says, Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish which you have just caught. Simon Peter went up and drew the net to the land. Now Simon Peter, they only bring him up with the other disciples that were there. They bring up Simon Peter because he was their leader. He was an unquestioned leader. They knew that he was the guy. He did that all the whole time. He made mistakes. He screwed up. He said dumb things. That is just who he was. He denied at times. He doubted at times. He feared at times. He was aggressive at times. He did all the things that we are. Simon Peter went up and drew the net to the land full of 153 great fish, even though there were so many the net wasn't torn. That's 5 years from home. See, when people read that, what they focus on is the 153 fish. The biggest catch ever. Like, I've never had a catch like that. But well, we caught nothing. And all of a sudden, this guy's on the shore. He's floating over here. We pull it up. And there's so many fish in it. So many fish. How many fish? 153. 153? Are you sure? Oh, yeah, we counted. You know, John counted them. And then Andrew counted them. And then Thomas counted them. We all counted them. We all came up, you know, the same number, 153. Those ones just pop around a little bit. Just getting away. We pull it back. 153. What happened to this? And that's the break. Are you serious? You're not getting break. All of our tickets. Over Carver. Carver, oh, no, the best man, yeah. Well, we got to change now. We got to go to this car. But let's know we're so far away, we're talking about all the fish and everything, that we miss God and what he's doing in the moment. Jesus wanted to spend time with them. Jesus wanted them to know that he was ready to feed them. But it also showed us that we get so caught in all the other details and everything outside of it that we lose sight of the loving Savior. Watch what Jesus does next. And this is the picture of who he is. Jesus said to them, come and eat breakfast. None of the disciples there inquired him, who are you, Lord? Knowing that it was the Lord. They knew this was Jesus. They could tell this was Jesus. They've already been told of two miracles. And if you're Peter, they've been told of three miracles. Because Jesus has already accepted him back. But one, we couldn't catch this whole night. All of a sudden, we caught them, and they didn't break the net. And how many? Only 153. We caught them that day. We pulled them all up, and all the disciples were brought to you. We did, and Jesus said, they're waiting on him. By the way, the whole focus here is upon what you did and your strength. The whole thing is that I want to invite you to be a part. let's do this together. Because disciples, you're about to move to apostles. This is going to be a choice that you make. And let's remember something. Every single one of these apostles, except one, died for their faith. They died for their faith. Some of them, oh, I'm not quite ready for that. Jesus didn't ask you to do so. He asked you to love others, to share the hope, and to bring them peace. He knows you're going to have doubts. He knows you're going to have fears. He knows you're going to be bad sometimes relationally. He knows you're going to make stupid decisions. Welcome to the crowd. But when you do those, you just give up. You beat yourself up. You knock yourself down. Or you stop long enough to go, oh, God, you know, and you knew that I was going to screw that up. God's like, yeah, I knew you were. But you know what? I need to turn to you. Yeah, that's what you need to do. Let's do this together. I invite you to don't try again. You're going to make mistakes because if you didn't make mistakes, you can't learn. But if you keep making mistakes and do them all on your own, you're not inviting me in. He invited us first. Just as with the tombstone that was rolled away, once the Jesus could get out, it was God inviting us in. God invites us in every single day. Are we going to continue to be disciples or continue to speak ourselves up? Are we going to become apostles so that others can see his light through us? On the next verse. Verse 13. Then Jesus came into the dead, gave to them, and the faith likewise. This was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to his disciples after he had risen from the dead. So when they had eaten their breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, so he fills them up, he gets them fed, and then he's getting ready to send them out. How many people here, be honest with me, how many people here do not realize that when you leave this church that there's a sign above the exit? Okay? There's an exit sign, and then right above it, there's a sign. And it says, you are now entering your mission field. In your own personal mission field. How cool is that? Wherever you go, wherever you work, wherever you play, wherever you live, you have your own mission field that God has given you personally. And if we want to be those disciples, to be those disciples, at some point we've got to make that decision. Do I want to be an apostle? To be an apostle is a messenger, is the one who takes the message. To our spouses, to our kids, to our neighbors, to our teammates, to people we've never met before. We get to go into our own mission field that God has blessed us with. How are you cultivating that field? What are you doing in that field? So we get fed here with God's word, but we get a chance to go out and do what we want to do with it. That's what Peter does. Jesus said to Simon Peter, think about this for a second. Simon Peter, you just came out with Jesus 3 times last time, you pressed on the 2nd time, you asked him to the picture the 3rd time, okay? And you realize this when you took on the water, you came on the floor, I had food for you, I fed you completely. And now we've got a conversation about it. Simon, son of Jonah. You love me more than these. Now, we don't know what these are. Do you love me more than this? Do you love me more than disciples? Do you love me more than what is you, where you work? What is it? Do you love me more than all of those? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I have affection for you. He said to him, feed my lambs. He was directing him. You love me, so be part of that. Take that love and feed others with it. Feed them with that love. Feed them with that hope. Have, let them know that there is a possibility that the only God can heal, but that God wants to heal. He said to him, feed my lambs. He said to him again, a 2nd time, Jesus said to him, Simon, son of Jonah, do you love me? He said to him, yes, Lord, you know that I have affection for you. He said to him, tend my sheep. He said to him a 3rd time, Simon, son of Jonah, do you have affection for me? You have loved this, like so unbounded, like you can't even understand, you can't even measure. You have this brotherly love for me, you have this agape love for me, you just love me. Peter was grieved because he asked him the 3rd time, do you have affection for me? He said to him, Lord, you know everything. You know that I have affection for you. Jesus said to him, feed my sheep. Feed them. So if you believe truly that God loves you so much that he sent his one only son, he cares about you so much and he's willing to give you eternity, then why is it that we can't share that love with others? The light, there's 153 things that get in the way. Because the brand new net that they got get in the way. Because, oh my goodness, the weather's bad today gets in the way. Because, man, I have these thoughts and I'm beating myself up and I'm in my own little jail cell and God wants to handle every single piece of that. He is so big for all of us. that we get to hear this message. But he's so personal that this message means something different to you than it does to me. There's something inside that says, this is my life. And this is what's going on where I live and where I work. And what's happening at my home or in my community. It's different for every one of us. It is our mission field. We can't deny it. And it's great to be coming here to be disciples, but when you're walking out and you see that sign, I love when people just jump up and touch it and smack it like they're going out to play football. Boom, that's my sign. I am heading into my mission field. But when you cross that threshold and you get in your car and you head back, it's up to you to what you choose to do in that mission field. And it's up to you as to what you choose or who you choose to do that way. But we order for ourselves. Do we need the credit? Do we need the headlines? If it's a person on the other end, you know what they need? They need to know that they're worth it. They need to know that, man, even if I deny Jesus 3 times, even if I deny him 10 times, 100 times, that he would be here for me. That he would stop long enough to say, I love you just as you are. Don't go fixing all that stuff. He didn't fix any of those things. He didn't get up and say, Jesus, I'm so sorry that I denied you 3 times, man. The second time was really bad because the first time I saw you, you looked at me, oh, man, I could barely look at you. He didn't do that. He had lost his friend. He was gone for 3 days. He was given a second chance, and he was going to get to wherever Jesus. And what did Jesus do? Jesus didn't chastise him. He didn't put him down. You know what? Peter should have done this. Let's get 3 Hail Marys. Let's do 2 Our Fathers, or whatever it might be. All the penance, all the stuff that you have to do first. And then he didn't do any of that. He said, come on. Let's do this together. But know this. I fed you. You've been fed. Now go and feed my sheep and feed my lambs. It's a choice that each of us make every day. And when we do so, who are we going out for? The story continues. Starting in verse 18. Feed my sheep. Let your man tell you, when you were young, you dressed yourself and walked where you wanted to go. But when you rolled, you would stretch out your hands, and another will dress you and carry you where you don't want to go. Now, he said these things signifying by what kind of pet he would glorify God. When he said, and when it said that, he said to him, follow me. The first thing that he said to his disciples, follow me. The last thing that he said to Jesus or to Peter is, follow me. Wasn't Peter following the whole time? Yes, he was. He was following as a disciple, and now he needs to follow like one to be an apostle. No matter what's going on inside of his heart, no matter what's going on inside of his brain, it's a choice that we make personally. It's a choice that we make in the mission field that God has given us. Do we feed? Do we love? Do we bring hope? That's verse 1. Peter, turn around. Saw a disciple. Saw a disciple following. This was a disciple whom Jesus loved. The one who had also leaned on Jesus' breast at the supper and asked, Lord, who is going to betray you? Peter, seeing him, said to Jesus, Lord, what about this man? Jesus said to him, if I desire that he stay until I come, what is that to you? You follow me. We get a comparison game, don't we? It's the easiest thing to do. Well, that guy has more money, that guy has a nicer house, that guy, he has the ability to do it, and he has better means, and he has more time. He's retired, so he's got 24 hours, he can do whatever he wants in this day. And that's where we miss. Because we set time aside for God occasionally through our week, but we don't carry with us daily in all those moments. It can't just be that God is first in our life. God has to be first in our life within every relationship we have, every loving relationship, every person we come across, every time we meet a sheep, every time that we meet a lamb. Now, are sheep and lambs believers? Not necessarily. They could be complete strangers. God wants us to lead with His love, and He wants us to care for them. And guess what? Along the way, we're going to find some sheep that are believers. And these might have been signed away. We're going to find some that aren't. We're going to find lambs that have no clue that have never heard the message of Jesus. We're all going to be in your mission field and my mission field. What we do, what we choose to do, is up to us. Jesus said to them, if I desire that these things will I come, what's that to you? You follow me. Here's the note on that. Peter just had this great conversation about loving and tending to others. And what's the first thing that Peter does? He wants to know what Jesus wanted to do with John, the writer of this book, and one of the other disciples. That's so typical of Jesus. We're always comparing ourselves to others in many different ways. Jesus doesn't tell Peter Peter to choose to follow Jesus, just as it is up to John and you and me to follow Jesus. Be careful not to get stuck in the comparison game instead of asking God, what about in regards to someone else? Get in the practice of asking God, what next, and keep the focus on your personal walk with Him. I got a note this week from the missionary. He said to me, he said, John, really, the main thing that's taking place. I went out to a house to meet people, and I've been going from house to house. He said, these people have so little. He's like, they don't have Bibles. He's like, they have no one that's going to be able to reach them. They're all planted together in different areas. But the church has never gone out there, and he goes, I made the choice to go out there. He goes, it's so poor in this area. And he goes, they have no chance of hearing about Jesus. They have no Wi-Fi. They have no internet. They have no cell phones. They don't have any of that kind of stuff. He goes, but now they all have the gospel on. They're all studying this together now because of the work that God is doing. Because God has put it on my heart. And some people are going, oh my goodness, can I hear that? Oh my gosh, we don't have Wi-Fi. And how do they hear? How come these people didn't hear every single day? Whereas, instead of looking at those things, we don't look at the things that truly matter. What matters is there is a missionary who's choosing to go out in his mission field. He has no clue what they didn't have. When he came to all that stuff until he got there, but when he knew that they needed, he took to them. He's doing it house by house. He's doing it family by family. He's doing it by reaching to the church in the area so they can then reach out to people. It's the choice that he makes. But it's kind of funny that what they need to go out to do is they don't have Wi-Fi, they don't have internet. Because that's how we connect now. Everything is through social networking. Everything is through Facebook. Everything is through Snapchat, Instagram, all those kind of things. But we tend to take for granted, and what else does that do? It kind of takes us away from our purpose. It kind of pulls us away from caring about people within our mission field. Now, I'm going to show you this last video, and this is from Jorge. Jorge is a guy, hopefully he's going to come back in September. So I'll share a little bit about who Jorge is. Jorge is the brother of Beth's Spanish teacher. So you know a little bit about the story. Jorge's brother is JP. That's what we call him. His name is Juan, but you know, my name is Juan in Spanish, and we don't want to get confused with one another because, well, so Juan, JP, was the second translator for the Spanish version. The first translator for the Spanish version is the guy by the name of Michael, Michael Wallace. We call him Walleye. And I remember the very first day that he and I had a conversation because the girl that he brought to church was not happy that Walleye showed up with. He's sitting in here, by the way, right now. Anyway, Walleye doesn't show up, but he's going to help with the translation. And as he starts in the first chapter of the translation, he plays soccer, he gets hit in the face of a soccer ball, and he goes blind. So, we can't use it anymore, so we take him out. Don't forget. And we go to, I'm making this up, but I'm not. We go to JP. JP, can you step in and do this? Because literally, our first translator went blind, and he's kind of like, well, that sounds all that great. How about we use my brother instead? He didn't do that. He said, I'll help. And so, you know, everything gets straight away. He just sort of knows, well, like we're seeing now, he's got his first vision. He's had two kids since that time, so all kinds of great things are happening. And he's still, like, using the times to send stuff, famous this, for the translation. Yeah, that looks good, and that helps, you know, teach it, whatever. JP, he's in the exact same way. JP has a brother. He's in Ecuador. And so you don't know, here recently in Ecuador, they have some major things. There's a forest rainstorm, there's a volcano, there's everything down. That's through the streets. They had mudslides everywhere in the city in which he lived. It was awful. Jorge made a decision that, okay, now when we're coming back, at all these translations, I can now go out and reach people. And so he decided different media organizations. He's going out, he is caring for people right where they live. And so he put a video together and he sent us a message, John, I just want to share with you what is going on in Ecuador. So Tim, if you could go ahead and show this real quick.
Thank you. Vamos, continuamos.
Esta es mi mudanza.
The intention is to take one piece of the Bible and help people understand it and share it with others. It is also meant to study this together and talk about the world, the motive tied to the world, and eventually send us into the Bible to understand more of it. We started with the Gospel of John because it is the universal gospel. It was meant for everyone. It shows and shares Jesus in a way the other gospels do not. It also has a couple of them.
Going to come up to sing this invitation song. shortly you're going to be entering your mission field. And you know what that looks like. Who is it you can care for today? Who is it you can reach out to? Who is it you can send a text message to? And well, seriously, I'm going to study what I'm uploading this study all the time. I'll read this book, it'll make more sense, we'll talk about it. Just one piece of time, maybe sometime this week. We can meet, we can talk, we can do over text messages, we can do it on the phone, whatever. Just take some time. What does it look like in your world? You walk into your work, and I know that I don't have the best amount of time. I know I don't always say the right things, and you probably don't think I'm crazy, but the one thing I probably need to share with you is I'm not a believer, but I'm not the best believer. Sometimes I even the don't things I say, don't think, we're starting to study. I'm going to study the gospel time. We're doing it alongside of you. We can read different things, we can talk about it. What does your world look like so that you can take that step from disciple to apostle to share that message? Because in the end, when you're feeding sheep and feeding lambs, you're just loving them right where they live. Heavenly Father, challenge us today. Challenge us as we walk out, God, whoever that person is that's on our mind or our heart. But before we ever cross the threshold to enter our mission field, help us to grab a gospel of John, to grab a study book, and help us then to go and reach someone in our world. Because God, you showed us as a believer that we matter. When you said, feed my sheep and feed my lambs, you didn't say feed the believers. You said feed everyone. So God, it's up to us to do so. God, help us to run with love and commitment. Help us to bring others hope because you bring us hope. And God, through this time, through these studies, Lord, help us to help others to find the peace that you promised me in your love. So we love you. We thank you for this time together. I'm going to ask you to bow your head one last time. If you've ever taken that step, will you stop long enough to recognize God for who He is? Stop and say, man, I admit that I need you. I believe in you. I have taken that step of faith. Thank you. Will you stop and say, God, it's lovely because I am. And today I want to take that step towards you. I want to ask in my heart as my personal Savior. I believe in you. I believe you sent your Son for me. And this step of faith today that I take is reason not for you to ask me in my life. That's a step that you've never taken before. That's a step you want to take today. Right? You stand, you raise your hand. Okay. Everyone open your eyes and take a look. Don't take this challenge lightly. I'm going to help you do what you need. It's about our church. It's about God's kingdom. It's about what matters to God. It's up to us whether or not we choose to feed His sheep and His lambs, which are never mine. Now, next week is Mother's Day. You best be taking care of your moms. And without them, you aren't here. Nice. All right? So, let's not wait till next week to celebrate. Let's start celebrating today. But, remember, there's a surprise to you. To get back here and find out what that prize is. And all you have to eat. One of those three are before you do it. Sorry? Worse. So next week, go to challenge yourself. Stand your computer in your different field. Grab a Gospel of John, grab two, grab three. Whatever you want to read. If the Bible says it right next to them, if you want out, it will be behind. But still love others. Just not love us first, but business to others.
Everybody, how are we doing? Glad to see you guys all out today. A couple quick announcements. Well, thanks for everything that's going on. I think, obviously, it's not that much better. If you need one more information on that, you can register. Make sure to go to the church. And that's the end of the book. So, we have studies going on Thursdays of 6 to 8:30. And
church.